I said, every time the feasts come in, the enemy seems to attack. And it just seems to be going on all the way around. But you know what? We already have the victory. All we got to do is receive it in Him. All right, blessing. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam. Asher natan lasekvi vana lahavkin vein yom uvein laila. That's in English. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, that gives us the heart of understanding to distinguish between day and between night. And most of the time, like I said, that's what it really is about, light versus dark. And by no means, do not be deceived. We're in a war.
Every day.
Every day, exactly. And people that walk around in wartime and don't, you walk around casually like there's nothing going on, get their heads blown off. And so when Christians are going, I don't understand what's going on, it's because they don't realize they're at war. And if they don't act that way, the enemy is just going to have a heyday with them.
They walk around in ignorance, oblivious to what's going on around them, except for those few who actually know what's going on here. We'll see like groups like these.
Well, we're under siege.
We prepare ourselves.
Yeah, we're under siege. Deuteronomy 6, 4-7 says, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might, and these words which I command you this day shall be in your heart. Mark 12, 29-30 says, And Yeshua answered him, The first of all the commandments is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. And so in Hebrew, Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Hashem, Yevod Melkutah, Leolam Baed. English, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Blessed is God's glorious majesty forever and ever. And everybody said,
Amen.
Amen. Shema in the Hebrew does not merely mean to listen, but to listen and to obey. So like I said before, it's no different than when you tell your kids you're not listening. It doesn't mean they didn't hear you. It means they're not doing what you told them. And as I said before on it going through, we finished Bereshit. Now we are in Shemot. And these are the names in the Hebrew of the books. Now, we're using the Greek word, which is Exodus, which means to departure in English. But the Hebrew word Shemot is actually the plural word for names. And so the book is called The Names, and that's why when the book starts out, it starts out with the names of those that went into Egypt, and it goes into the names of those that came out. And we are going a journey through the book of the Exodus, or Shemot. And this is my outline again on Exodus. And as you remember, last week we covered chapters 1-6, which was the birth of Moses and the call of Moses. And we touched on Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the name of God. And this is basically about slavery, and that's why I was touching about us relating all of this to the slavery. We've been enslaved in this world. We were in bondage to this world. All of this stuff that we're reading here is pertinent to us today. This isn't something that happened a long time ago. It's something that's happening to us on a daily basis. Now, today we're going in from 7-10, which is the conflict with Pharaoh, and then next week, I will be covering 11 and 12, which will be the Passover. And so I'll be doing it on the Feast of Unleavened Bread. So we'll have already done the Passover, but I'll be starting out with chapter 11 and 12 on Exodus. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to tie it into the Last Supper and the crucifixion and the timeline as well with that. So on it, this whole beginning part that we're starting it is the deliverance from oppression. It's getting Israel out of Egypt. When we get to chapter 19-40, it will be getting the Egypt out of Israel. Because that's what we're dealing with right now. First, God gets us out of the world. Then he gets the world out of us. That's the sanctification, and that's what we're going to be looking for. So thus far, we dealt with in Egypt. Now we're going to be dealing with God's salvation. And so we're starting God's salvation today and the method that God's using for it. So we're in the second book, as I said, Exodus. This one is on the plagues, God's way to punish Egypt. Exodus chapter 7, verse 1. And the Lord said to Moshe, see, I have made you a god to Pharaoh, and Aaron your brother shall be your prophet. And you shall speak all that I command you, and Aaron your brother shall speak to Pharaoh, that he send the children of Israel out of his land, and I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and multiply my signs and my wonders in the land of Egypt. But Pharaoh shall not hearken to you, that I may lay my hand upon Egypt and bring forth mine armies and my people, the children of Israel, out of the land of Egypt by great judgments. And the Egyptians shall know that I, the Lord, when I stretch forth my hand upon Egypt and bring out the children of Israel from among them. Now, a lot of people, I've heard it before, saying, well, you know, God, that wasn't really fair because God tells you he hardened Pharaoh's heart. It's kind of like it wasn't his fault, right? But that's not really the way this is coming in. Pharaoh's already made his choice and his decision. All God's done is affirm him in his decision and choice. Since this is all a picture of what's going to happen in the last days, it's no different than saying, well, gee, that wasn't really fair for the Antichrist, right? But you got to remember, last week when we were covering it, he put affliction and burdens on the people of Israel. He enslaved them, right? And basically, he put heavy burdens on the people. This is God coming in to deliver them, but he's going to deliver them showing his power. And not just his power over Pharaoh, not just his power over Egypt, but his power over all the non-gods of Egypt that they trust in. And Moshe and Aaron did as the Lord commanded them, so did they. And Moshe was 40 years old, and Aaron was 43 years old when they spoke to Pharaoh. And the Lord spoke to Moshe and to Aaron, saying, when Pharaoh shall speak to you, saying, show a miracle for you, then you shall say to Aaron, take your rod and cast it before Pharaoh, and it shall become a serpent. The word is actually tanin there. Yes, Danny.
Well, I think I was reading 80 years and 83 years for Aaron.
Yeah, Moses was 40 years old. No, he's 80 years old. Yeah, what's going on there? Well, Aaron's only 3 years older. I knew that Aaron's 3 years older. But he was 40 years old when he left Egypt. He was 80 years old when he came back.
Just a typo. Typo people.
Yeah, but I'm wondering how the typo came in there. I copied and pasted. That's a little scary. Yeah. What happened there?
Now, sometimes you got to remember that these books are an accumulation of pieces of paper all over the place that they brought together and put together for Exodus.
Yes.
Some of these pieces of paper, or papyri, whatever you want to call it, some of them will have one age on it, and some of them will have another age on it.
Yes. And I've said this before, the one thing I have found, no matter what translation of scripture that you get, every one of them has a bias. I found that there's not one translation or one Bible that doesn't have some kind of bias involved with the translation of the scriptures on it. So there's always a little bias, but I found that God still has found a way and managed to be able to keep his word intact,
sure,
despite that.
Yeah, I wouldn't call them errors. I would just call them, they were written by different people, perhaps accumulated, and they didn't want to change it. They put it in as it was written.
Now, you guys, most of you guys have heard me teaching on the tanin before, so you're fairly familiar with it. As you know, tanin, as nachash is the shining one, but basically because of the scales. Usually they translate it snake. But tanin is the same one that was from Isaiah 27:1 that says, in that day, talking about the day of the Lord, with his swift and mighty sword, talking about the sword from his mouth, he will crush the heads of Leviathan the crooked serpent, Leviathan the fleeing serpent, and the tanin, the dragon in the sea. And on this, if you look at it, you'll notice that it's a tanin that it actually turns into, not a snake. So I thought that was kind of interesting. I myself personally believe that a better translation for it is reptile. These are all the references in scripture of just the tanin. The first one, of course, is in Genesis 1:21, which you've heard me quote before, on the fifth day when God created the fishes and the birds. Exodus 7:10 is where we're at now. Deuteronomy 32:33, it covers it. Job 7:12, 30:29, Nehemiah 2:13, Psalm 44:19, Psalm 74:13, 148:7, Isaiah 13:22, 27:1, which I mentioned, 34:13, 35:7, 43:20, 51:9. Now this one over here is actually kind of interesting too, because of the fact that that scripture, I don't think I stuck that on the charts. My bad. One of the ones kind of interesting over here too is in the scripture there, where in Ezekiel 29:3, where he tells Pharaoh, and he says, "Pharaoh, you are the tanin, the dragon in the sea. And I will make the fish stick to your scales, and I will basically lay you out for the birds to eat your flesh." And so, of course, my little picture that I did here for my tanin reference. There were reptile birds, there were reptile fishes, and there were reptiles on the land. Exodus 7:10, 11, it says, "And Moshe and Aaron went into Pharaoh, and they did so as the Lord had commanded. And Aaron cast down his rod before Pharaoh and before his servants, and it became a tanin. Then Pharaoh also called the wise men and the sorcerers, now the magicians of Egypt, they also did in like manner with their enchantments." There's my tanin. I did a Komodo dragon. And they threw it down, and they also, for they cast down every man his rod, and they became serpents, but Aaron's rod swallowed up their rods, and he hardened Pharaoh's heart, that he hearkened not to them, as the Lord had said. And the Lord said to Moshe, "Pharaoh's heart is hardened, and he refuses to let the people go." So then, I had a video, but, you know, I've had really bad luck with playing video clips here, you know that. So I just went ahead and did a couple of clips of the dragon eating the serpent. Okay, we're coming into the first plague. God changed the waters in Egypt of the Nile River into blood, killing all the fish and any other aquatic life. This plague was an attack on the Egyptians' worship of the Nile River, which sustained their livelihood because the area was so dry that only the Nile River made that land fertile. It's kind of hard to live in desert if you don't have some source of water. Water is actually the most valuable commodity out in the Middle East. They got oil all over the place, but, you know, what they do is they use their money for that to basically bring in the water they need. Verse 15, "Get you to Pharaoh in the morning. Lo, he goes out to the water, and you shall stand by the river's brink and come against him. And the rod which was turned to a serpent shall you take in your hand, and you shall say to him, 'The Lord God of the Hebrews has sent me to you, saying, Let my people go, that they may serve me in the wilderness. But indeed, until now, you would not hear. Thus says the Lord, by this you shall know that I am the Lord. Behold, I will strike the waters which are in the river with the rod that is in my hand, and they shall be turned to blood. And the fish that are in the river shall die, and the river shall stink, and the Egyptians will loathe to drink the water of the river. Then the Lord spoke to Moshe, say to Aaron." Now if you notice, each time Moses tells Aaron and then Aaron does it. "Take your rod and stretch it out your hand over the waters of Egypt, over their streams, over their rivers, over their ponds, over all their pools of water, that they may become blood. And there shall be blood throughout all the land of Egypt, both in buckets of wood and pitchers of stone." And Moshe and Aaron did so, just as the Lord commanded. So he lifted up the rod and struck the waters that were in the river, in the sight of Pharaoh and in the sight of his servants. And all the waters that were in the river were turned to blood. The fish that were in the river died, the river stank, and the Egyptians could not drink the water of the river. So there was blood throughout all the land of Egypt. Then the magicians of Egypt did so with their enchantments, and Pharaoh's heart grew hard, and he did not heed them, as the Lord had said. So the very first one was him turning the waters to blood. And Pharaoh turned and went into his house, neither was his heart moved by this. So all the Egyptians dug all around the river for water to drink, because they could not drink the water of the river. And 7 days passed after the Lord had struck the river. Now, this was the first plague. God did this through Moshe, which actually was through Aaron. The gods that he was striking against were Num, Hapi, and Osiris, were associated with the plagues. Moses struck the water and turned it into blood, just as the Lord had said. The Egyptians had no drinking water because of this. Now, they expected their gods to protect them. Hapi was the god of the flood. Hapi was especially important to the ancient Egyptians because he brought the flood every year. The flood deposited rich silts on the banks of the Nile. As you notice, you see with him, he's got fish, he's got vegetables, because the wealth that came from it was basically coming from Hapi. So basically, this was God showing his superiority over Hapi. Khnum, the god of the river Nile, I'm sure I'm going to massacre all of these Egyptian names, the god of the Nile, religion, and the river. The river Nile was essential to the Egyptians for survival because in the Egyptian times it barely ever rained, so it was the main source of water. Every July the Nile would overflow, on both sides would be covered in thick black mud, and this was called inundation, and was so vital, it had its own god. Num was in charge of the river and inundation. Inundation was so important because of it, because it did not happen, all the crops would die. That was what was essential, basically, for them to be able to have crops coming in there. And so, basically, this is the god. And see these pictures that I have on the side like this? Well, unfortunately, through video games, these gods are still alive and well today. Now, this was something I thought was kind of interesting, so I went ahead and put it in here. They talk about characteristics common in the Nile Delta region, especially in the summertime. Nutrient-rich red soil particles spill into the Nile River. Harmful toxic red algae called dinoflagellates grow to very high levels, especially in September. Harmful algae levels require three major factors: long hours of daylight, warm temperatures, water rich in nutrients. Harmful algae live in saltwater seas and estuaries where fresh water is blocked from reaching the open sea by salt marshes and barrier islands. This normally kills the fish in the river within days of the week of the algae outbreak. Now, God could have did it through the algae. I personally, he could have made it into real blood for all I know. But usually God has methods that he usually uses for doing this. One of the problems I had with this, it says especially in September. Well, as you know, we were in the springtime.
Right.
This wasn't that time of year. It's in the waters. Now, each time on this, what you're going to find is you're going to notice a common thread here between the plagues from the Exodus and the ones you have in the book of the Revelation of Jesus. Mm-hmm. If you recall, when you get to the second trumpet judgment, the seas are turned to blood. Mm-hmm. When you get to the third trumpet judgment, the rivers and the fountains are turned to blood. Mm-hmm. When you get to, that's a third of them each time. When you get to the second bowl judgment, all the seas are turned to blood. Mm-hmm. When you get to the third bowl judgment, all the rivers and fountains are turned to blood, and there's no water left. Okay, first four plagues. Now, the next plague that was that of frogs. 7 days after the first plague, frogs appeared all over the land and hopped everywhere. And the Lord spoke to Moshe, "Go to Pharaoh and say to him, 'Thus says the Lord, let my people go, that they may serve me. But if you refuse to let them go, behold, I will smite all your territory with frogs. So the river shall bring forth frogs abundantly, which shall go up and come into your house, into your bedroom, on your bed, into your houses of your servants, on your people, into your ovens, into your kneading bowls. And the frog shall come upon you, on your people, and on all your servants. Then the Lord spoke to Moshe, say to Aaron, stretch out your hand with your rod over the streams, over the river, and over the ponds, and cause the frogs to come up on the land of Egypt. So Aaron stretched out his hand over the waters of Egypt, and the frogs came up and covered the land of Egypt. Now, you know, normally you think, wow, what kind of a plague is that? A bunch of frogs, right? Mm-hmm. You know, depends how many frogs you've got. Because, you know, I imagine these in your kitchen, in your bedroom, yeah, not too pleasant.
If you can't even find a place to step and you squish on it.
Yeah, everywhere you're stepping, you're probably squishing a frog. Yes.
Kneading bowls.
I know. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Not good. Not good. And the magicians did so with their enchantments and brought up frogs on the land of Egypt. Then, that's great, now more frogs. That was a good plan. Then Pharaoh called for Moses and Aaron and said, entreat the Lord that he may take away the frogs from me and from my people, and let the people go that they may sacrifice to the Lord. So we had a few frogs. And Moshe said to Pharaoh, accept the honor of saying, when I shall intercede for you, for your servants and for your people, to destroy the frogs from you and your houses, that they may remain in the river only. So he said, tomorrow, and he said, let it be according to your word, that you may know that there is no one like the Lord our God. I love that word. There is no one like the Lord our God. And the frog shall depart from you, from your houses, from your servants, from your people. They shall remain in the river only. Then Moshe and Aaron went out from Pharaoh, and Moshe cried out to the Lord concerning the frogs which he had brought against Pharaoh. So the Lord did according to the word of Moshe, and the frogs died out of the houses, out of the courtyards, and out of the fields. They gathered them together in heaps, and the land stank. I'll bet. But when Pharaoh saw that there was relief, he hardened his heart and did not heed them as the Lord had said. So the Lord said to Moshe, say to Aaron, stretch out your rod and strike the dust of the land, so that it may become lice throughout the land of Egypt. Now, touching back on the plagues of frogs. In Egypt, frogs symbolized the Babylonian politicians arguing. The frogs also made it hard to sleep. Pharaoh was warned, but was not with Moshe when it happened. The Egyptian god associated with this was Heth. Heth was the frog god. And it was they usually associated this with their politicians. I can kind of relate to that. I have this standard rule, I think I've told you guys before, when it comes to elections, I don't vote for lawyers or politicians. Very limits your options, real highly. Oh, go back a sec. Also, if you're going to look in it, it's kind of interesting because there's a vague association here to the frogs when you get into the bowl judgments. Because when you start getting towards the end of the bowl judgments, when the river Euphrates is dried up to make the way for Armageddon, it talks about three frog demons coming out of the mouth of the of Satan, out of the mouth of the false prophet, and out of the mouth of the false Messiah. And so it talks about them that were the spirits that basically gathered all the armies that led them to get together for Armageddon. So that's it's kind of a vague one. It wasn't exactly a plague of frogs, but it was one that brought armies. Now the third plague, the Pharaoh would still not let the Israelites go, so God sent a third plague of lice through Moses and his brother Aaron. Aaron beat the dust to make the plague of lice. And they did so, for Aaron stretched out his hand with his rod and struck the dust of the earth, and it became lice on man and beast. And the dust of the land became lice throughout all the land of Egypt. Now, the magicians so worked with their enchantments to bring forth lice, but they could not. So there were lice on man and beast. Now, I think if they were able to bring forth lice, that wasn't going to help the situation too much. You know, more lice. But what's kind of interesting on it is you stop and think. When back in, remember when we were covering in Bereshit on creation? and we talked about what did God use to make everything. How you doing, Paul?
Dust.
He used the earth.
Well, for man.
He made, no, for everybody. Everything, if you'll notice, everything was formed from the earth.
Yeah.
The animals he formed from the earth,
yeah.
Everything was formed from the earth. And so it's kind of interesting, because once again, where is he getting the lice? From the dust of the earth.
The firmament too? From the earth, the firmament?
No. No, because you had the heavens and the earth. If you notice, heavens, Hashamayim, the last part of the word, Mayim, is water.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting that there's an association to the heavens with waters.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at it where he put the stars and the sun and the planets in the midst of the firmament, it means, he said there was the waters above and the waters below the earth, and that in the midst he put the stars. Which means our universe is encapsulated in water.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting.
I have a question.
Yes.
In my NIV, it says gnats.
Yeah. They use the reference gnats and they use the reference
so
lice.
So gnats and lice, same thing?
They refer to both of them commonly. Me
gnats
personally,
fly.
I think lice make a much better plague than
gnats.
Gnats
fly
yeah.
And lice.
Yes.
But they were biting.
Besides that, he brings a plague of flies after this.
Yeah, I see. Yeah.
Yes. Okay, and they did so, for Aaron stretched out his hand with his rod and struck the dust of the earth, and it became lice on man and beast, and all the dust of the land became lice throughout the land of Egypt. Now the magicians so worked with their enchantments to bring forth lice, but they could not. So there were lice on man and beast. Now it's interesting, because this is the first one you get to. Remember, basically you had two plagues. You had the frogs, and you had the waters turned to blood. By the third plague, they couldn't copy it. Then the magician said to Pharaoh, "This is the finger of God." But Pharaoh's heart grew hard, and he did not heed them, just as the Lord had said. Even the magicians are realizing, hey, we can't do this. This is God's doing this, because this isn't something you can fake. And the Lord said to Moshe, "Rise early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh as he comes out of the water. Then say to him, 'Thus says the Lord, let my people go, that they may serve me.'" And, you know, I like to put something in that brings the plagues into a little bit more of a feel of what we're really dealing with here. Because when you just read it, it doesn't quite have the same impact as when you actually see it.
Yes.
Now, the god that it would be hitting was Geb, the god of the earth. The lice from sand. Appearance, man lying down below the arch of the sky, the goddess Nut. Nut was his sister. He actually married his sister. In the Egyptian culture, that the god of the earth married the god of the skies. The plague would have been an embarrassment to Geb. The Egyptians gave offerings to Geb for the bounty of the soil, yet it was from the dust of the soil that the plague originated. Priests shave hair, impure with lice, unable to perform sacred tasks to beseech their god to help. Because, you know, they got lice, so they had to shave their heads off, all the hair off, and that defiled them from being able to do their tasks. Yes, Paul.
You know what that picture means?
Yeah. This is Geb, the god of the earth. This is Nut, the god of the heavens, and this is man in between. And so basically, they were brother and sister. But you know, they got a god for everything. They got a god for the earth, a god for the heavens, a god for everything. The one thing you find in the within the world, and that is, even the stuff that was copycatted from the real god, the pictures of Messiah they took, they turned them into demigods and made all kinds of them. You know, and so you see this throughout a lot of it. Because a lot of this stuff, the one thing about Satan is he does not have the ability to create. All he has the ability to do is pervert. Yeah. So basically most of the stuff he did and most of the things he took were perversions that he took from the real God. And that's how he created most of the religions that he did. That's why you have so many similarities, where you have Perseus, the son of the Father God, born to a mortal woman, who comes riding in the clouds on a white horse to fight the beast from the sea to save the chained woman. That's like right out of the book. Why? Because he took God's prophecies and he perverted them. Yes?
Well, we've got to remember that Revelation tells us that Satan is a counterfeit.
Right.
He's a counterfeit God. So he's going to counterfeit everything God does, just going to do the opposite.
Right. Well, he can't create. He can't create. So all he can do is take what God created good and find a way to pervert it. The trick a lot of times is not throwing the baby out with the bathwater, is figure out what was the good part he took before he perverted it. Because usually he started everything God made good in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And then the enemy found a way to pervert every bit of it. Because
mm-hmm.
he takes it out of its proper place. Anything that you take out of its proper place is usually going to get perverted.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the appearance was a bearded man with a goose on his head. Kind of interesting, which makes sense. If you got lice, how are you going to get rid of it, right? The goose is going to pick all the lice up. Now, Geb was considered the god of the earth.
That was why I always had lice. Now imagine the other
okay. Right, right.
So,
Egyptians
so,
believe that Geb's laughter, yes.
Lice, they lay eggs.
Yes.
And they multiply.
Yes.
The only way to get rid of them.
You have to comb them all out. Yeah, and that's why they usually had to shave their heads.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. Egyptians believed that Geb's laughter caused earthquakes. Egyptians had feared he might imprison the dead, and he married his sister Nut, who was the goddess of the skies. Oh, nuts. I know. Okay. The fourth plague. The fourth plague was an infestation of flies. When this plague came upon the Egyptians, the Pharaoh promised Moses that he would let the Israelites go, pray in the desert, if only the plague was taken away. But after God did so through Moshe, the Pharaoh would not keep his word. Now, what you're going to find throughout this, and you know, this is the thing that was the thing that impressed me the most in all of this. Over and over, Pharaoh turns around and says, I've sinned. Pray for me. You guys can go. And then he turns around again. And does God take away the plague each time?
Mm-hmm.
Each time. How many times?
Nine.
Like, oh my gosh. It's well, and as you go through this, you start looking at it and you say, how much grace is there?
Right.
What, look what we're looking
long
at.
Suffering.
Over and over and over.
Yeah.
Chauncey?
Yes.
That's an exhortation for us as well, because you know, we have a tendency to abuse God's grace a lot of times when he forgives us for things and we kind of, oh, okay, and we kind of let stuff back in.
Well, and that's one of those things too, and that is God gives us grace to learn to keep his commandments.
Mm-hmm.
But we should never take that grace lightly.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because as we sin, we're re-crucifying Christ over and over again.
Right.
It's dangerous.
Dangerous.
If we abuse the blood,
yeah. Well, yeah. Romans tells us on there. It says, you know, if we take the grace for granted, as you see in mainstream Christianity today, hyper grace, you know, where basically it's like, oh, God will forgive me. Well, he says, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. If you love me, you'll obey me. And God is gracious and he's forgiving, and even though we fall short and even though we fall and stumble, he continues over and over to forgive us and pick us up. But the idea behind it is so that we can learn through the grace he's given us, that we learn obedience. Or as I like the way Steve puts it, you know, it's like the little kid that you have where, you know, he goes into the kitchen and he's going to make mom breakfast and destroys the kitchen. And says, look, Mom, I made you breakfast. And how do you get mad at that?
Yeah.
And I'm sure God's looking down at us, seeing the pitiful job that we're doing, trying to be obedient.
Uh-huh.
And
you made him breakfast.
Saying, you're trying.
At least you're trying.
Yes, and you know what? Thank God he looks. But you've got to remember, too, though. Who can know the heart? The Lord who searcheth the heart. He says, is deceitfully a wicked above all things. I, the Lord, searcheth the heart. All right, moving on. Or else, if you will not let my people go, behold, I will send swarms of flies on you and your servants and on your people and into your houses, and the houses of the Egyptians shall be full of swarms of flies, and also the ground on which they stand. And in that day I will set apart the land of Goshen, in which my people dwell, that no swarms of flies shall be there, in order that you may know that I am the Lord in the midst of the land. Now, if you'll notice, he's separating now Egyptians from Israelites, mm-hmm. saying, look, I want to show you that my people are set apart. That I am showing a distinction and a difference between the Egyptians and my people.
So the frogs and the lice.
Yeah, everybody was hit with that.
About another arrow right there. Chapter 8,
not 2. Oh, yeah. Thought that looked funny. You know, I actually kind of went through real quick and fixed. I think I found six of them. This is what happens when you're doing this at 2 in the morning.
We won't pick you apart. You're doing an excellent job anyway.
Yeah, I try. I always seem to get chapter ones wrong there because I recycle the previous ones when I make my new ones, and usually some of them don't get the numbers all changed. Yeah. I will make a difference between my people and your people. Tomorrow this sign shall be. And the Lord did so. Thick swarms of flies came into the house of Pharaoh, into his servants' houses, and into the land of Egypt. And the land was corrupted because of the swarms of flies. Now, have you ever had those annoying flies where they won't leave you alone?
Yes. Fruit flies.
Yes. Oh, the fruit flies, yeah, those ones are bad too. I hate those ones. Yes. Then Pharaoh called to Moshe and Aaron, and he said, go sacrifice to your God in the land. And Moshe said, it is not right to do so, for we would be sacrificing the abomination of the Egyptians to the Lord our God. If we sacrifice the abomination of the Egyptians before their eyes, then will they not stone us? We will go 3 days' journey into the wilderness and sacrifice to the Lord our God as he will command us. Now, on this, he's saying, okay, you know what? Fine, you can worship your God. Do it here. Right. He's saying, we can't do that.
It doesn't work that way.
So, he says, no, we have to go 3 days' journey out into the wilderness. That's right. You know what? Yes, Scott.
What was the idea of the 3 days? And going
3 days' journey? Well, that's how long it was going to take him to get back to Mount Sinai. Because remember he said, come back to the mountain to worship him? It was a 3-day journey.
But again, at this time, he's planning on, he knows what's going to happen, but he's actually only asking for this time off.
Correct. Yes. And I was going to touch on this, not next week, but the following week. Had Pharaoh not hardened his heart and gone after them, they would have had to come back to Egypt.
Yep.
But what breaks the covenant?
Death.
What happened to Pharaoh?
He died.
No longer under covenant. If he had not turned and gone after them, despite the fact that he broke his word over and over and over again every time in this, they would have had to come back and keep their word and come back to Egypt. But God knew what he was going to do. And so God had already planned for their deliverance.
The paths of righteousness of his namesake.
That's right.
Wow. So God will kill for his people.
Well,
yes, he
will. If you look, wait till we get to next week's, when we get to the firstborn struck, and you see who is it that struck the firstborn.
Yeah.
So Pharaoh said, I will let you go, that you may sacrifice to the Lord your God in the wilderness, only you shall not go very far away. Intercede for me. Then Moshe said, indeed, I am going out from you, and I will entreat the Lord that the swarms of flies may depart tomorrow from Pharaoh, from his servants, and from his people. But let Pharaoh not deal deceitfully any more in not letting the people go to sacrifice to the Lord. So Moshe went out from Pharaoh and entreated the Lord. And the Lord did according to the word of Moshe. He removed the swarms of the flies from Pharaoh, from his servants, and from his people. Not one remained. Now that's amazing in itself, that not one remained. Yeah. But Pharaoh hardened his heart at this time also, neither would he let the people go.
Consider how common flies are in the desert. I should know, because first Gulf War, flies are everywhere.
Yeah.
Sure, Packing is grabbing people to send us fly swatters.
Oh.
By the box full, believe me. And there's even and there's really cool ones that have like a little like bullseye.
I like the ones that have the little shock button where you snap. Capri, the sun god. Capri is a form of the sun god Ra. He is usually depicted as a human with a beetle on his head or as his head.
Aren't those dung beetles?
Yes. It's exactly what they are.
Oh, I hate those things.
Yes. He rolled the sun across the sky, much like the dung beetle rolls a ball of dung.
Yeah, rolls it backwards.
His name comes from the Egyptian word kapur, or to become. Now, the interesting part about it is, in the Maseroth, when I was teaching on the constellations, Cancer is actually a dung beetle. It was made a crab later on, but originally in the Egyptian Maseroth, it was a dung beetle, and it was he who holds fast. Now, this is kind of interesting on it, because the way the whole reason that they would relate Khepri to Ra, the sun god, was because he rolls it, and he was because they were saying, well, Ra is the one that rolls the sun around to come back up again, just the same way that the dung beetle would roll it. But what attracts... What do flies eat?
Dung.
Yes. And so Capri, the dawn bringer, this was basically an indirect thing. And I'll be honest, there's probably other gods you can associate with a lot of these. I picked what seemed like the most likely to me. I've seen multiple lists where people were picking different Egyptian gods. There's a lot of them you can relate to it because there were so many different aspects. Basically, God was coming against all the gods of Egypt.
Amen.
Genesis chapter 9, the fifth plague. After this came the fifth plague, a disease on the livestock of Egyptians. But still, the Pharaoh would not let the Israelites go because God hardened his heart to show the world that he was and is the master of nature.
Mm-hmm.
Then the Lord said to Moshe, go into Pharaoh and tell him, thus says the Lord God of the Hebrews, let my people go, that they may serve me. For if you refuse to let them go and still hold them, behold, the hand of the Lord will be on your cattle in the field, and on horses, and on donkeys, and on camels, and on oxen, and on the sheep, a very severe pestilence. And the Lord will make a difference between the livestock of Israel and the livestock of Egypt. Once again, he's separating his people from the people who rule. Now, this is important. Remember I said all of the things that God did here in Egypt were a symbolic picture or type shadow of what God's going to do in the last days?
Mm-hmm.
Do you notice he separates his people from the other people?
Mm-hmm.
You notice when you get to that third horseman,
mm-hmm.
right? Famine.
Mm-hmm.
And he says... but don't harm the oil or the wine.
Mm-hmm.
What's oil represent in Scripture?
Anointing.
Anointing. So he's saying, don't hurt the anointed. What does wine represent? Joy.
Mm-hmm.
Don't hurt the anointed and the joyous.
Mm-hmm.
So in other words, this famine isn't coming on God's people. God is providing for them. God is protecting them.
Mm-hmm.
He's our provision. As you see through all of this, because, you know, I really hate when I hear people with the pre-tribulation rapture thing come in and say, you know, if we had to be here during this, God is beating up his bride before the wedding. No. That's not the book I'm reading.
Showing off his bride.
Well, it is. He's showing off his bride. And in the process of this, what you see in all of this is, like the Israelites in Egypt, did God deliver them out of Egypt, then bring plagues down on them?
No.
They were in Egypt when God brought the plagues down.
How's that showing them off like
hey, I tell people, look, is Jesus our example?
Yes.
Yeah. Did he suffer?
Yes.
To the point of death, to the cross.
Mm-hmm.
Are we not supposed to lay down our lives for him?
Yes.
How can, if we're going to follow his example, how would we live any other way?
Yeah.
You know, I know, and you know what? I want the impact of what God did on these plagues to hit, because these were plagues. A lot of times, you know, they've been done into little kids' stories where they're kind of pretty and cute. Well, you guys aren't little kids. I think you can handle the truth.
Sophie's over there.
Then Pharaoh sent, and indeed, not even one of the livestock of the Israelites was dead. But the heart of Pharaoh became hard, and he did not let the people go. So the Lord said to Moshe and Aaron, take for yourselves handfuls of ashes from the furnace, and let Moshe scatter it towards the heavens in the sight of Pharaoh. So now he throws up the ashes. But the fifth plague, the cattle, that was a symbol of deity that they had, a judgment against their economy. Now, I'm glad we don't have a bull that's a symbol of our economy. Basically, the god was Apis. He was the god of agriculture and fertility. He was the funeral god, too. His Egyptian name was Hap or Hepu. Now, it's interesting on it because as you look at this and you say, well, wait a sec. He's the god of agriculture and fertility. And he's also the funeral god. Well, the agriculture just all had a big funeral. So basically, once again, over and over, God shows his authority over all the gods of Egypt. And one by one, he wipes them out. Now, most of the time, people look at this and they relate this to when they made the golden calf in the wilderness. I have a little different slant on it, and whether I'm right or wrong, I don't know. But that pillar of fire that came through there, that led them through the wilderness, when you read Ezekiel of what they see in that pillar of fire, there are four cherubim. One of them has the head of an ox with the legs of an ox. Now, my view on it was that they're looking up into that pillar of fire, they're seeing one of the cherubim, and they're saying, that's the God that led us out of Egypt. Because I think they were sincere when they said, this is the God that led us out of Egypt. I think they were sincere, but God said not to make an image of anything on earth or in heaven. So it don't matter whether or not they think that's God, they're still not supposed to be making an image and worshiping.
You know, that makes sense, too. Yeah, but back to the bulls in the economy, well, there is, we do have a bronze statue of a bull right in front of the New York Stock Exchange.
He was being sarcastic.
And we also have, and also the symbol, it's also a logo for...
Sarcasm kind of goes over his head.
It's also the symbol for Merrill Lynch.
For Merrill Lynch. That's why, sure because
is.
Of a bull market. Yes.
And
the sixth plague. Got to move on.
Yes.
The next plague was of boils that formed upon the Egyptians and could not be cured. These boils also broke out upon the Egyptians' animals.
I thought the animals were already dead.
Well, if you recall, the people that heeded the voice of the Lord and put their animals inside didn't get struck. It was only the ones that didn't heed the voice of the Lord, and the Israelites didn't get struck. But the ones that heeded God, their animals lived. And it will become fine dust in all the land of Egypt. This is where he throws the ashes in the air. And it will cause boils that break out in sores on man and beast throughout all the land of Egypt. Then they took ashes from the furnace and stood before Pharaoh. And Moshe scattered them towards the heavens. And they caused boils that broke out in sores on man and beast. Poor donkey. Go back to the donkey. And the magicians could not stand before Moshe because of the boils, for the boils were on the magicians and on the Egyptians, and on all the Egyptians. But the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, and he did not heed them, just as the Lord had spoken to Moshe. So even Pharaoh got boils. You know, and... Yeah, everybody got boils. And they're not pretty. Now, the interesting thing on this is if you take this and you look towards the one, like I said, if you look at the plagues and the first bowl judgment, is what? Sores that break out on everyone who has the mark of the beast.
Mm-hmm.
If you'll notice, it's once again distinguished. It says, who does it come out, who does it break out? Mm-hmm. On everyone who has the mark of the beast. Now, the god was Thoth. He was the god of writing, wisdom, music, and spells. He was also their god of medicine.
So what is the mark of the beast?
The Mark of the Beast? That's another Bible study.
Okay.
Not going to do that tonight.
Okay.
I can go a whole night just on that. He symbolized the moon. His Egyptian name was Dehuti. And they always have him with the, you know, the long beak. They always do that. But basically, he represented the god of medicine. Later on in the other cultures, he was known as Asclepius.
Asclepius.
You're probably familiar with the symbol. They took it from the bronze serpent. It's the staff with where you have the serpent wrapped around, you see on the ambulances.
Yeah, it's a single serpent.
Yeah, single one, yes. The double one was actually the god of commerce. Very appropriate for today. The seventh plague. Hail and fire made up the seventh plague, destroying all the crops of the Egyptians. Then the Lord said to Moshe, "Rise early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh and say to him, 'Thus says the Lord God of the Hebrews, let my people go, that they may serve me. For at this time I will send all my plagues to your very heart, and on your servants and on your people, that you may know that there is none like me in all the earth.'" Now, if I had stretched out my hand and struck you and your people with pestilence, then you would have been cut off from the earth. And it's true. God could have wiped him out. But then how would he have shown his glory and his obvious, obvious power over everything else?
Say your
that
people,
their gods were
not
gods.
His people anymore, it's your people.
Exodus 9:16 says, "But indeed, for this purpose have I raised you up, that I may show my power in you." Mm-hmm. Why is God bringing these plagues? According, God raised him up for this purpose. That he could show his power, that he would have a way of showing the deliverance of taking them out of bondage and giving them salvation.
Mm-hmm.
"And that my name may be declared in all the earth, as yet you exalt yourself against my people in that you will not let them go. Behold, tomorrow about this time, I will cause very heavy hail to rain down, such as not been in Egypt since the founding until now. Therefore, send now and gather your livestock and all that you have in the field, for the hail shall come down on every man and every animal which is found in the field and is not brought home, and they shall die. And he who feared the word of the Lord among the servants of Pharaoh made his servants and his livestock flee to the houses. But he who did not regard the word of the Lord left his servants and his livestock in the field. Then the Lord said to Moshe, 'Stretch out your hand towards heaven, that they may be hail in all the land of Egypt, on man, on beast, and on every herb of the field throughout the land of Egypt.'" Now, see where it says right here, the word of the Lord?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
You know how many times that appears in the Bible? A lot. Well, that's the reason they came up with, during the time of the Messiah when he came, they were teaching in every synagogue at that time about the Memre, the word of the Lord. And they had taken every scripture that had a reference to the word of the Lord throughout all the scriptures, and they basically broke it down into seven attributes of it. They had determined that the word of the Lord had a mind, will, and emotion. That the word of the Lord was like God, but separate from God in other places. That the word of the Lord was the means by which God brought salvation. That the word of the Lord was, normally I have
creation.
These on the top of my head.
Creation.
Yeah,
creation.
Right, by the means that God brought forth creation. Thank
mm-hmm.
you. She's been to a lot of my Bible studies. Yes, but what you find interesting is that in the beginning, in the first chapter of John, Yohanan, when he does his gospel, he touches on four of those, that he's specifically talking about something that is being talked about in the synagogues all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And he's saying, look, this word of the Lord that you've been talking about is Yeshua,
right.
The Messiah.
Right.
All right. "And Moshe stretched out his rod towards heaven, and the Lord sent thunder and hail, and fire darted to the ground. And the Lord rained hail on the land of Egypt." Now, I don't know about you guys. I have seen hail, but I've never seen fiery hail. That's a little new for me. "So there was hail and fire mingled with hail, so very heavy that there was none like it in all the land of Egypt since it became a nation.
Yeah, I don't see like Revelation. The hill, because it's not the natural kind that we're familiar with, directly shows it came from God, not anything.
Right, that it wasn't just, well, just and I don't think Egypt's really known for their hailstorms either. So this was not really common in that area. But what I find kind of interesting too is, once again, you go to the Revelation one, you get to the seventh bowl, the final plague coming down, which, if you'll notice, if you read what's happening in that plague, the earthquake, the hailstones, many of the cross references for the second coming of the Messiah have the exact same references of the same hailstorm, of the same earthquakes, and of the other things that are coming in. And so, me personally, I've looked at that, I align that seventh bowl judgment with the second coming of the Messiah. And it's kind of interesting because there's a lot of cross references on it where he talks about the plague of hail, where Job talks about the hail, storehouses of hail that he saved up for the day of the Lord. Examples of the seventh plague and the movie Hail.
All these were the birthing of the first fruits.
The birthing of the first fruits. 9:25, and the hail struck throughout the whole land of Egypt, all that was in the field, both man and beast, and the hail struck every herb of the field and broke every tree in the field. Only in the land of Goshen, where the children of Israel were, there was no hail. And Pharaoh sent and called for Moshe and Aaron, and said to them, I have sinned this time. The Lord is righteous, and my people and I are wicked. Wow. Isn't that amazing? Yes. Confession. Yes. Yes, see how long it lasts. Exactly. Now, one of the things I think is kind of interesting in this, too, is when you look at this, I still look at Psalm 91 as a prophetic psalm. When he says, those that dwell in the secret place of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of my God, he is my rock and my fortress, in him will I trust. Right? When you go down there and you see where he talks about, you know, I won't be afraid of arrow by day, or, you know.
The arrow that flies by day.
Right.
The pestilence that falls in
waste at noonday.
The destruction that lives at noonday.
And 1,000 will fall at my side, and 10,000 will fall at my right hand, but nothing will come near me. He says, no plague or pestilence will come near my household. Mm-hmm. And that he'll give charge to his angels to see that I not even dash my foot upon a rock. Mm-hmm. Now, that's the same verse that Satan quoted to, to Yeshua. Mm-hmm. But I actually believe that that's a prophetic psalm talking about the believers in the last day that are being protected. Mm-hmm. When you look at it, here's the scary thing on the two, when you look at the fact that after we're taken out, the wrath of God comes down on the bowl judgments, and the Jews that do not believe Jesus is the Messiah are going through the bowl judgments. We know this because they're at the Armageddon War where the armies are coming to wipe them out. And it's then when they cry out to God, and it says that those that pierced him will weep over him as over a lost son. Mm-hmm. And it says that at that point they turn back to God and they never depart from him again. Right. But they had to go through the bowl judgments.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But obviously God had to supernaturally protect them to go through it.
Purification, huh?
Well, and these are ones that, like I said, I don't believe these are ones that know that Yeshua is the Messiah. So they had to actually go through the bowl judgments to get to a point to finally recognize him.
They have to go through trial by fire.
Trial by fire. Right? That's a lot of fire.
Wow.
Entreat the Lord that there may be no more mighty thundering and hail. For it is enough. I will let you go, and you shall stay no longer. So Moshe said to him, as soon as I have gone out of the city, I will spread out my hands to the Lord. The thunder will cease, and there will be no more hail, that you may know that the earth is the Lord's. Mm. Mm. But as for you and your servants, I know that you will not yet fear the Lord God. Now the flax and the barley were struck, for the barley was in the head of the flax, was in the bud. Right? Well, of course, the barley harvest always comes in just before Passover time, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the wheat and the spelt were not struck, for for they are late crops. So Moshe went out of the city from Pharaoh and spread out his hands to the Lord. Then the thunder and the hail ceased, and the rain was not poured on the earth. And when Pharaoh saw that the rain and the hail and the thunder had ceased, he sinned yet more, and he hardened his heart, and he and his servants. She was the night goddess. She was called the big one who gave birth to the gods. She was the creator of the universe and the stars. Now, we know God's the creator of the universe and the stars, and all of these are basically an atrocity in it. Mm-hmm. So, what he's doing is he's basically showing his... I want to say predominance. Not, is it predominance over them?
It's dominance.
Dominance. Just dominance. Yeah, predominance didn't sound right. Yeah. Dominance. Yes. Exodus chapter 10. Now, like I said, on the hail that came, the hail was the same that happens at the seventh bowl judgment that comes in. Now, the eighth plague. The eighth plague was comprised of locusts that ate up every living thing in the land of Egypt. Now, the Lord said to Moshe, "Go into Pharaoh, for I have hardened his heart and the hearts of his servants, that I may show these signs of mine before him, and that you may tell in the hearing of your son and your son's son the mighty things I have done in Egypt, and my signs which I have done among them, that you may know that I am the Lord." So Moshe and Aaron came into Pharaoh and said to him, "Thus says the Lord God of the Hebrews, how long will you refuse to humble yourself before me? Let my people go, that they may serve me. Or else, if you refuse to let my people go, behold, tomorrow I will bring locusts into your territory." He even warns them beforehand. Mm-hmm. Each time he's warning them ahead of time.
He's just.
"And they shall cover the face of the earth, so that no one will be able to see the earth, and they shall eat the residue of what is left, which remains to you from the hail, and they shall eat every tree which grows up for you out of the field. They shall fill your houses, the houses of all your servants, the houses of all the Egyptians, which neither your fathers nor your father's father have seen since the day that you were on the earth to this day." And he turned and he went out from Pharaoh. Then Pharaoh's servants said to him, "How long shall this man be a snare to us? Let the men go, that they may serve the Lord their God. Do you not yet know that Egypt is destroyed?" So Moshe and Aaron were brought again to Pharaoh, and he said to them, "Go serve the Lord your God. Who are the ones that are going?" And Moshe said, "We will go with our young and our old, with our sons and our daughters, with our flocks and our herds we will go, for we must hold a feast to the Lord." Mm-hmm. You know, you look how fervent God was, I'm going to use the word fervent, about his people keeping a feast to him.
Yep.
I mean, I think it's so adamant when you go through everything on it, how important and how pertinent. When we get to next week's, I want you to take note, just in two chapters, how many times God says the word forever and permanent statute.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Then he said to them, "The Lord had better be with you when I let you and your little ones go. Beware, for evil is ahead of you. Not so. Go now, you who are men, and serve the Lord, for that is what you desire." And they were driven out from Pharaoh's presence. So he's saying, you know what? Nope, you don't get to take your little ones. Then the Lord said to Moshe, "Stretch out your hand over the land of Egypt for the locusts, that they may come up on the land of Egypt and eat every herb of the land, all that the hail has left." So Moshe stretched out his rod over the land of Egypt, and the Lord brought an east wind on the land all that day and all that night. And when it was morning, the east wind brought the locusts. Lots of locusts. And the locusts went up over the land of Egypt and rested on all the territory of Egypt. They were very severe. Previously, there had been no such locusts as they. nor shall there be such after them. For they covered the face of the whole earth, so that the land was darkened, and that they ate every herb of the land, and all the fruit of the trees, which the hail had left. So there remained nothing green on the trees or on the plants of the field throughout all the land of Egypt.
Yeah, it's actually a dark cloud.
Yeah.
I mean, if you read,
that's not even enough locusts.
No.
That's a very poor representation, but it was the best I could
Little
find.
Little House on the Prairie has an excellent rendition.
Oh, okay. See?
The Banks of Pumpkins.
And I have it on disc. I probably should have put it
no,
up, pulled
not
it off
the
video.
TV version, the book version.
Oh, the book
TV
version. Yeah, I don't think the TV covered it really well. Okay, verse 16. Then Pharaoh called for Moshe and Aaron in the haste and said, I have sinned against the Lord your God and against you. Wow. Again he repents. Wow. Now, therefore, please forgive my sin only this once and entreat the Lord your God that he may take away from me this death only. So he went out from Pharaoh and entreated the Lord again.
Sir, I don't think he was really repenting because he hardened his heart.
Really?
I think so.
Okay. Wow.
Yeah.
And
because, I mean, he has to take him for his word.
I think you're right.
Love all things.
I think you're right.
And Moses was very meek, so.
Yes, he was the humblest of men, is what God said about him.
Pharaoh
now,
wasn't
you know what?
Repentant. He wasn't.
That's one of the things you look at. I mean, for God to say that Moses was the humblest of men, you know, and you know, if you look at it, he went through so much, so much. And when we get to the part where he strikes the rock, that's kind of a difficult one there because you know you kind of feel like, wow, with everything he went through, and he doesn't get to go into the promised land.
He snapped. He had to keep the reputation of being the meekest man.
Do all this enough. Do not
bring
that
he
up.
Wanted him to
he misrepresented God.
I
yeah.
think that he wanted him to maintain the reputation of being the meekest man.
But
well,
even more,
yeah.
God's picture of him.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
You know?
And the Lord turned a very strong west wind, which took the locusts away and blew them into the Red Sea. And there remained not one locust in all the territory of Egypt. But the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he did not let the children of Israel go. Now, this would have been the god Osiris, the god of fertility and agriculture. He presided the judgment of the dead. His skin was green. He held a whip and a crook, and his wife was Isis. You probably know Isis. And their son was Horus. Well, if you remember, Osiris and Isis are the same ones that were renamed. Isis is the one that became Ishtar. The fertility god who was also Venus and Aphrodite and so on. And Diana. Yes. 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 And like I said, unfortunately within video games, these gods are still alive and well today. The ninth plague. Still this Pharaoh would not let the Israelites go. We're on the ninth plague. This is the last one I'm doing tonight. We saved the tenth plague for Passover for next week. Still the Pharaoh would not let the Israelites go, and so God sent the ninth plague, a plague of thick darkness that covered the land. Then the Lord said to Moshe, stretch out your hand towards heaven, that there may be darkness over the land of Egypt, darkness which may even be felt. Have you ever been, it was so dark you could actually feel the darkness?
No.
So Moshe stretched out his hand towards heaven, and there was thick darkness in all the land of Egypt 3 days. It's interesting, 3 days, huh?
Yeah.
They did not see one another, nor did anyone rise from this place for 3 days, but all the children of Israel had light in their dwelling.
Mm-hmm.
Now that's interesting, right? You got Goshen, it's in Egypt, light there, rest of Egypt dark. Yeah, you can't even see the pictures, but that's a house.
For real?
This was the ninth plague. This made it hard to see and do any daily activities. These are the gods that are associated with the plague. Re, Amun-Re, Aten, Atom, Horus, and Thoth. Pharaoh still didn't let them go. Now Ra, the god of the sun god Ra was worshipped as the greatest of the gods and labeled as the supreme deity because he was the god over the sun. Where was he? Where were the? Where was their moon gods?
Yeah.
He is the big god. He is the god of the sky. He is the beginning of life in ancient Egyptian mythology. Ra symbolized solar light. He was the sun god worshipped by the Romans later on. And he was in charge of the dead and the resurrection cycle. Well, it's a good thing he's in charge of the dead, because he's got plenty to go with after this. So basically, as you come through this, you see too, where basically they took God, who was the creator of the universe, who made everything, and they make him into these other gods. And they basically turn him into like people, but even more, they turn him in like animals. And as I said, you know, these ones are alive and well today in video games, sadly. Then Pharaoh called to Moshe and said, "Go serve the Lord, only let your flocks and your herds be kept back. Let your little ones also go with you." But Moshe said, "You must also give us sacrifices and burnt offerings that we may sacrifice to the Lord our God." Oh, also I wanted to mention on the darkness, in Revelation, you have, when you get to the bowl judgment, you have darkness on the kingdom of the Antichrist, or the kingdom of the beast. I find that one kind of interesting, because when I was younger, I'm looking at it, you know, each time the plagues are escalating, right? And when you get into the bowl judgments, now we're in the wrath of God. And as a kid, I'm going, darkness, that's it?
Right.
That's, I mean, we're like getting like to the last bowl judgments in darkness, right?
Yeah.
It wasn't until later on when we started becoming a electronic age. And basically where electromagnetic fields, when they knock out everything, people die. Lots of people die. And basically, I think the darkness it's talking about is going to be from the bomb that wipes out Babylon. And that electromagnetic field, the EMP, is going to bring in a darkness that's going to wipe out a lot of lives in that alone, just because planes are crashing. Life support's going down. Lives stop. And no video games. What are they going to do? What are the kids going to do?
Refrigeration,
everything else. Our livestock also shall go with us. Not a hoof shall be left behind. For we must take some of them to serve the Lord our God. And even we do not know what with what we must serve the Lord until we arrive there. But the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he would not let them go. Then Pharaoh said to him, "Get away from me. Take heed to yourself and see my face no more. For in the day that you see my face, you shall die." So Moses said, "You've spoken well. I will never see your face again." Said that one right. So the seventh to the ninth plague, God told Moses, then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand." The eighth one, then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand." If you'll notice, it was Aaron earlier on it. When it gets on it, now God is moving Moses into a position where he's bringing the plagues, because he said, "I will make you like God unto Pharaoh." Well, it talks about, he says, the humblest of men. God says he lifts up the humble and he brings low the proud. These are basically the 10 plagues that we went over. Now, here's what I want to touch on the timeline. As you know, as I've been covering the timeline and everything, this one I was cramming an awful lot of chapters in, and so we covered as much as I could. As we ascertained before, that Amenhotep the third was the Pharaoh at the time that Joseph was made governor, right? And as we went on down through that, what we found on it too, as I showed you in last week's, that you only had four generations going from Levi to Moshe. And basically Moses' birth would have come in right here. If you'll notice, 1759, it jumps to 1696. There's a big gap between there where they're not telling you who the pharaohs were at that time. And as you go through here, basically this would have been the pharaoh at the time that Moses killed the Egyptian and fled into Midian. Which basically would have brought it down to here. This would have been the pharaoh at the time that Moses returns. Now, that pharaoh was actually Sobekhotep VII. As I mentioned before, what made this really difficult is the fact that every pharaoh during the 13th dynasty had five names, basically pertaining to the different gods. That really made it a lot harder on this. But Sobekhotep VII only reigned for 2 years, and after he reigned, it was then that the Hyksos came in and took over Egypt, and it was the intermediate time before the new kingdom came in. Mm-hmm. And one of the Egyptian poets said it, I'm sorry, no, it was an Egyptian priest that was commissioned to basically document the history of Egypt, wrote that before the Hyksos came in, that Egypt was struck by the hand of God. And that these foreigners were able to come in and take over because of that. And that this is this intermediate period that came in before they were able to basically restore Egypt during the new kingdom. And once again, I've got more stuff. As I've been going through all of this, I showed you the documentations already on the Waterway of Joseph, which was named Waterway of Joseph at the time of Menenhet. I showed you the governor's house, which was built in an area with all Semitic houses, which was the only Semitic houses in the Egyptian area. I showed you that the governor's house had 12 tombs there, of which the governor's tomb was a mini pyramid, which is the only pharaoh that was never, that was the only person that was not a pharaoh that had a pyramid-shaped tomb, and that his body wasn't in the tomb. And that the statue of him had a coat of many colors on it. And as I continued to go on through there, I also showed you where there were the males decreased and the females increased at the time when the when they were killing the babies. Mm-hmm. I showed you as it went through the Hebrew Semitic slave lists that they had, which there were three papyruses that basically covered the Hebrew slave lists. And now going on to here, we go back to the Ipuwer papyrus. In a poem, Ipuwer was a name typical in the period 1850 to 1450 BCE, which falls right in that same time frame. Ipuwer papyrus has been dated no earlier than the 19th dynasty, but around 1250, which is why they say there's no way that this could have been talking about Egypt at that time, because it was way too early for that to have happened. Around 1250 BCE, but it is now agreed that the text itself is much older and dated back to the Middle Kingdom, which is when all of this is taking place. More precisely, the late 12th dynasty. Now, in the Ipuwer one, it talks about the rivers turn to blood. Huh. It talks about the men thirsting after water. It talks about the gates, the columns, and the walls are consumed by fire. It talks about everywhere barley perished. It talks about the cattle moan because of the state of the land. It talks about that men are few, and he who places his brother in the land is everywhere, and that the children of the princes are dashed against the walls. It talks about pestilence is throughout the land, and it talks about that the land was not light or bright, and this is a guess of translators because of blank area that they put in on the papyrus, which normally they didn't do that. And then it talks about gold, the piece, the silver, are strung on the necks of maidservants.
Oh, yeah. Hmm. Wow.
And then these are all the scripture verses that basically correlate with that. But of course, I'm sure this had nothing to do with the plagues of Exodus. Now, the El Irish Stele, found in 1887 on a farm in El Arish, northeast of Cairo, the black granite shrine marker stone known as the El Arish Stele is now in the Egyptian Museum of Ismaila. See, she knows how to pronounce it. It is covered with hieroglyphic inscriptions, some of which describe historical events in that area. Velikovsky used part of the inscription to help validate the biblical book of Exodus. And basically, this is the stone in there. There's actually been, as you said, I've been finding tablets. I've been finding papyrus scripts. I've been finding stuff that they dug up. It goes on and on and on. And we find more again for next week's. And it continues. And once again, these are the plagues and the road that they came. Why did the Egyptians disobey? Because they trusted in their Egyptian gods whom they worshiped. They believed that their gods would be able to stand and protect them despite all the warning given by God through Moses and Aaron. And they wouldn't listen. Are we any different? You really look at it. The world is not listening. The word's being preached more over anywhere. Go ahead.
Would you say that Pharaoh disobeyed and not the Egyptian people disobeyed? Because Pharaoh was basically talking to the people, I think, after the second plague.
But if you'll notice, it said Pharaoh and his officials, God continued to harden their hearts. He hardened their hearts, too.
Correct, but yeah. People, just like the Egyptians, didn't they say, like, you know, enough's enough, just give in, get them out of here?
Some of the Egyptians did.
Yeah. Now, next week, we're going to be covering the mixed multitude that go with the Egyptians out of Egypt.
Yeah. With the Israelites.
Yes, exactly. Now, does God show partiality? Well, God is not a respecter of persons, but he's definitely separating the people that were his from the people that were not. And in the process of this, many of the people that were not became his through this.
Mm-hmm.
Now, one of the things I relate this to is when you're going through the trumpet judgments, right? The shofars were warnings of repentance.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The prophets were called shofars because they warned the people of repentance to turn around, to make shuvah. Right? Now, each of these trumpet judgments comes, it comes, and as you get towards the last ones, God's kind of going like, and they still didn't repent. Like, what is it going to take? They didn't repent from their murders, and their thefts, and their sexual immorality, and their sorceries. Right? But then, if you notice, when he gets to the last trumpet, the last shofar, what happens just before that trumpet's blown?
The dead?
Yes. The two witnesses rise up, a great earthquake that kills all the people, and what does it say? And the people glorified God.
Yeah.
It was that last little bit he was waiting for to repent and turn around at the last minute.
Yeah.
Yes.
Like you were saying, this Exodus story is like a type shadow of Revelation.
Yes.
Moses and Aaron, and then the two prophets.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's really beautiful.
And it is a beautiful picture, because what we're getting on this, you see the parallel in the plagues. Yeah. As I said, God's people were not, he didn't take them out of Egypt. Mm-hmm. They were in Egypt
mm-hmm.
when the plagues came down.
Mm-hmm.
But did God protect them?
Yep.
Yes. God watched over them. If you look at the trumpet judgments, who brings the trumpet judgments?
The prayers
of the martyrs. You see where, how long, O Lord, before you avenge your blood? And boom, you're right back at that altar of incense right before the trumpet judgments come in. So we're bringing, technically, I say we're because I believe I'm going to be a martyr. But we're bringing the trumpet judgments in by our prayers.
We can cry and wake you
hey,
up from the dead.
You only get one shot at dying. What better to do than go out for the kingdom of God? The best way you can go. Yeah. Now, well, nobody can go before their time anyway.
We can cry and bring you back.
Now, if you look at the bowl judgments, those bowls, what does chapter 5 tell you those bowls were? What were in the bowls?
The prayers of the saints.
The prayers of the saints. So who brings in the bowl judgments?
We do.
We do. Why? He says, how long?
Yeah,
you know, they're shedding our blood. How long before you avenge our blood?
Yeah.
So then what does it say? He says, he gave them blood to drink. Why? You are righteous, Lord, because you gave them blood to drink because they shed the blood of your saints.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Why is this stuff happening? Because of what they did to his people.
Mm-hmm.
Why is this happening to Egypt? Because of what they did to his
Psalm
people.
Psalm 51 verse 4, that you may be just when you speak, and clear when you judge.
Amen.
It's all about his reputation.
Yeah.
And
amen.
His integrity.
And you know what? God takes joy and pride in
mm-hmm.
keeping his word.
Absolutely.
And keeping his covenants.
Pride?
All right. Yes.
Did you ever do anything on, if it's only a 200 year gap in there, like
mm-hmm.
you're looking at that 200 year bondage,
yes.
for the 70 to go down into Egypt and then to come out, at least 2 million. Did you ever figure that? I mean, statistically, how that could be possible?
Yeah.
In that short period of time? We're talking a couple hundred years still. And it said that they were fruitful and multiplied quick. Well, you remember how many kids most of these were having? Israel had 12 sons and a daughter, 13 kids. You look at a lot of these, you look at Dan had 10 kids, right? Now you multiply those kids. Now even in four generations, you multiply out. I believe part of the reason for the million, if you're looking at the numbers in the wilderness, because when they are numbered in the wilderness, when we get to the book of Numbers, right? You'll see that how many there are not adding up to what we're talking about for a million people. So where did the rest of the million come in? The mixed multitude.
That's why God told us to be fruitful and multiply, because that's when the Egyptians became afraid of them, is because of their numbers.
Yes.
And that's why we're getting overrun today, because everybody's limiting their families.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes. That was a command, be fruitful and multiply.
But there's a foreigner.
It's still a command.
Muslims.
They're the foreigners that are coming and taking over them.
Right. It's the wrong group.
So, I mean, you've got to figure if they're having 12...
It's going exponential. Now, if you look, if you remember when I showed the genealogies from the tribes on it, when I showed Reuben and I showed Levi and I showed Simeon, if you recall on it, Judah had 5 generations going down. Levi only had 4. And if you notice, because when he married in, he actually married from the next generation up. He married his aunt. That was where, as I showed last time, that the priestly line married into the king line. Right there, coming into the time of Moshe, and that was in the genealogies. I said, remember last week when I was going through the timeline and the genealogies, and I showed you where the Judah line married into the Levi line. Whenever you have a picture of both king and priest together, that's a picture of Messiah.